Okay, so here we are with lesson one, and we're starting our unit on fields by talking about gravitational fields. We're going to talk about electricity and magnetism a little bit later in the unit, but pretty much these three forces, and really any force that acts at a distance, so it doesn't require contact, has an associated field. And a field is basically a three-dimensional kind of distribution in space where a quantity or a property like a force can be distributed. Okay. And so basically, it basically tries to describe in a vector way what the force looks like everywhere. And so let's say this was a little mass, and we know, of course, mass has basically all mass has this attractive force called gravity. So here at the middle, this little dot right here is some mass. And so what we could say is, oh, here's spread out in two-dimensional space. No matter where we go, we could have an idea about what the force of gravity looks like everywhere around this little mass here. And of course, this would be a field. And here, the brighter the vectors, the bigger they are. And then as they get dimmer and dimmer and dimmer, they of course get weaker and weaker and weaker. And we know that that's true. That the farther away you go from a mass, the weaker gravity is. So this is kind of just a graphic way of representing what a field looks like. But onwards to more specific things. When we took grade 11 physics, and for the last little while, we studied Newtonian gravity. And in Newtonian gravity, we saw this, which was Newton's universal law of gravity. And it basically says that the force of gravity between any two masses, M1 and M2, is basically equal to G, M1, M2, all divided by R squared. Okay, G is, of course, the gravitation constant. It has the value of 6.67 times 10 to the negative 11. And from here, we notice three things. First, we notice that the force of gravity is always attractive. Okay, so mass 1 will be attracted to mass 2 and vice versa. Okay, and so here's a little diagram of basically this. Gravity is never a repulsive force, it's always attractive. Interestingly enough, that because of this, we can note Newton's third law, and that's that the force of gravity acting on mass 1 is equal to the force of gravity acting on mass 2, but they're in the opposite direction. So this force vector right here and this force vector right here, of course, the same magnitude, and they are opposite in direction. So say the force on 1 because of 2 is equal to the opposite of the force on 2 because of 1. So Newton's third law holds. This is very interesting when you think about it. The force of gravity that the Earth is exerting on you is actually equal and opposite to the force of gravity you are exerting on the Earth, which is a little bit bizarre when you come to think about it. But also that the force of gravity is an inverse square law, which means that it's proportional to 1 over r squared. So we see this little r squared term in the denominator. And what we note at this point is that as you get farther and farther away from a planet, the force of gravity drops off very, very quickly. And it drops off as 1 over r squared, which is much more than dropping off as a linear relation. It drops off as the squared term. So let's take a look at a little example, and of course this will be complete review for most of you if you've taken grade 11 physics. The centers of two stone spheres sit a distance of 0.25 meters apart. Each sphere has a mass of 3 kilograms. Determine the magnitude of the gravitational force of attraction between them. Alright, so here's what we have. We know that G is equal to 6.67 times 10 to the negative 11. We know that R is equal to 0.25 meters. We know that M is equal to 3 kilograms. If we are to calculate the universal law of gravity here, or we're going to use the universal law of gravity to calculate the force, we simply substitute in our values, 6.67 times 10 to the negative 11 times 3 because the masses are the same, divided by 0.25 squared. I will remind you, do not forget to square. And you come up with 9.6 times 10 to the minus 9 newtons. Okay, so these two little tiny spheres, they sit this far apart. It's not much force, okay? So gravity is, of course, the weakest of the four fundamental forces of nature, and you can see why it is not very strong. Another example, though, dealing with masses that are a little bit bigger, and now taking our law of gravity to the next level, shows a distribution of planets. And so here I have planets P, Q, and R. P sits at the origin, Q sits at, of course, a location above the origin, R sits at a location along the x-axis to the right of the origin. All right, so these are three planetoids. They're little planets. They're arranged as shown in the diagram. Planetoid P has a mass of 2.0 times 10 to the 20 kilograms. Planetoid Q has a mass of 4.0 times 10 to the 20 kilograms. And planet R has a mass of 8.0 times 10 to the 20 kilograms. What is the force that's acting on planet P? Now, to do this, what we need to say is, oh, these two forces are in different directions. So I either need to use my I-hat and J-hat notation to give me what that force is that's acting on P, or I need to resolve these into horizontal and vertical components, find an angle, and discuss it like that. So this question I'm going to leave for you to try. It's a try this. Here's the answer. 1.7 times 10 to the 10 I-hat plus 2.1 times 10 to the 9th J-hat newtons. There's the answer. Try and figure this out. We'll look at it tomorrow in class if you don't get it. All right, moving on. Gravitational fields then. We've talked about the gravitational force. That's mainly review. A gravitational field is made up of an infinite number of vectors, and we kind of saw that in the little diagram, that basically when you take them together, they define the magnitude and the direction of the gravitational force for any object with mass. So if I were to, let's say I was to place a mass right here, some object with a mass right here, I could basically determine the gravitational force on that, because if I know what the field is, I know what the force is going to look like. And it's basically going to, you know, accelerate in this direction. Because if I know what the field looks like, I can figure out what the force is for any mass. So the gravitational field strength is a different term. So there's two different terms here. The gravitational field, which is this. It's basically all the vectors together. The gravitational field strength tells me the magnitude of the gravitational field at some point. And we can determine the gravitational field strength as follows. We say, okay, well, here's basically the force of gravity is equal to G times the mass of some object times the mass of some planet, right? Because here's a planet, and we're going to put an object in its gravitational field, and we're going to divide by r squared. Of course, r squared is how far away from the center of the planet it's sitting. And if we divide both sides by the mass of the object, if we divide this side by the mass of the object, it cancels. If we divide this side by the mass of the object, this is what we get. And so we're left over here with g times the mass of the planet divided by r squared. And this is what we define as the gravitational field strength. Okay, so this is important because for this planet, I can define a gravitational field. And the strength of that gravitational field, or how big it is equal to G times the mass of the planet divided by R squared, which is how far you are away. So I can find for any point anywhere around this planet, I can find how strong the gravitational field is. And that's defined as little g. And as it turns out, little g, of course, for Earth is 9.8. And so when you're at the surface of the Earth, g has a value of 9.8. And you can prove that to yourself simply by plugging in the values for Earth, mass of the Earth over the radius of the Earth squared, and you can find out what g is. As you go to different altitudes above the Earth and you get farther and farther away, of course, the gravitational field changes and it gets weaker and weaker and weaker. Okay, so the last little part of this lesson is a quick little example. Calculate the gravitational field strength on the surface of Saturn. Yes, we know Saturn is a gas giant. If it had a surface, let's find out what it would be. Assume that Saturn has a mass of 5.69 times 10 to the 26 kilograms. And a radius of 6.03 times 10 to the 7th meters. So here's our two knowns. This is what we were given in the problem. And we know that for Saturn, the gravitational field strength of Saturn is equal to G times the mass of Saturn divided by the radius squared. So because we want to know the field strength on the surface, this r squared term that you see in the denominator is simply just the radius of Saturn. If we were trying to calculate the gravitational field strength at some height above the surface of Saturn, then we would have to adjust this, and this would become the radius of Saturn plus whatever that height is, all squared. But that's not what we're being asked to do in this question. We're being asked to say, okay, well, here's 6.67 times 10 to the negative 11. We multiply by the mass, and we divide by the radius squared. And we come up with our answer that G is 10.4 newtons per kilogram. Yes, we could express G in terms of meters per second squared. But when we're talking about a gravitational field strength, usually we're talking about newtons per kilogram, because we're talking about force distributed over mass. Okay, and so we'll leave this in units of newtons per kilogram, even though it would be correct to write it in units of meters per second squared. Same exact units, but we'll leave it in terms of this for now.